Taking courage from T.S. Eliot, who called Kipling the greatest hymn writer on the strength of one hymn, I am calling Geoffrey Jellicoe the most important landscape architect of the 20th century on the strength of one book, which was published in three volumes. His Studies in Landscape Design are brilliant examples of how to explain the art of landscape architecture. And explanation is one of the things landscape architecture most needs. I see this video as a small supplement to the studies. It's a recording with new illustrations of a lecture Jellicoe gave to a group of students in 1984. He discusses the relationship between landscape architecture and architecture while talking about four of the design projects he was then working on, one in England, one in Texas, and two in Italy. Sadly, only Sutton Place was implemented, and only in part. I'm also sorry about the quality of my tape recording.
So I'd like to introduce Mr. Jellicoe, who many of you know. He gave talks about architecture and landscape, or more details, buildings and landscape, I think.
Well, I'm just going to refer to the relation of landscape architects to architecture, is what it is very interesting. So it's very nice to tell you guys what I saw when I heard in town with the education. Yeah, I was director of eight American universities. The best, in my opinion, the best architectural landscape school in the world. And of course, one says that one is called unpatriotic. But there's an element of truth in it that the quality of the learning here, I think, is fitting for a world that's coming, which is going to have an immense call on landscape architects. And for that reason, you must, I think, have your philosophy of science, not really worry about what you're doing. Very clear. Now, what I've done is to approach ourselves and our relationship in a new way. That is to say, to try and penetrate beyond the visible into the invisible, what lies behind the thing that we see. Now, that, of course, is the basis of all art. There are two things. There's a figurative, there's a thing that you see, and the other thing that you see, and so forth. And then behind it, now, is an abstract thought and design of the designer, which doesn't which combines with the figurative. So, two things form the somber. I think it's very figurative. It's a certain year, trying to get two worlds of it, the visible world and the invisible world behind it. And that's how they read it says, I suppose, at the Kennedy Memorial. And then I have a disaster of opportunity in Sutton Place, where I found a cloud who knew exactly what the problem was on the arts. With the passion to keep on the arts, immensely, and simply do it. And I said, I was good. And that's how I came about. My first astonishing year. Well, how am I not going to talk about something? I mean, it's a Sunday back now, because I'm going to change it, it's further on. And I can say, well, my aim, this is still progressing on. But you see, many of you, maybe out of the illusion, many of you, the life we live in Australia. Take it by the way, it doesn't seem related. In April, I'm going on my major work in the States. All the building is ideas that I'm going to show you a few slides of the creation of a form of environment which contains two worlds, the world that you see that you use, the world of fountains and lights and things and watch the world and so forth, and the world behind that, all the service, you know, so why we are here at all, our relation to the cosmos, and so forth. In doing that, one is endeavoring to lift the immense depth design into a part and a great art. And I think that you'll see the landmark that this is only the beginning. I'm hoping to pass on my exploration of the next great generation, like ourselves, and
33 two poems.
glorious that it was to be there. And in one respect, I'm interpreting that balance of ideality in the theatre of the speech. Now, this is the art of our art, which we take something perfectly ordinary, and by doing something to it, we get people's lives, and people feel, not very much, but they experience are much greater than that everyday ordinary artists. And I would take the next slide. Well, we are beginning to build up the grandeur of landscape in relation to a region. And now we come on to what I think is the most interesting thing in the history of landscape, is the mirror. And there, I want to so much to see the rejection of painting singing in London. The editor had no common editor that they wanted this to be a landscape conception and not a public conception. Now, this was the first sketch, and you can see that there's an element of surrealism going on here. If you look at this, these line shapes and these views and so forth, there's a slight element of pattern. Now, here is a detail of later. Let's say, we might talk about it. Some people don't matter, I might do it. So I'll have to say something. And I said, what she does, I do, is that she interprets them into reality. And now, this is a tremendous scheme. You see, if you remember that link, it's down there. This is a canal. This great canal here. And this is the city, is lies underneath this botanical garden. Now, there was a lovely description by E.M. Forster, who's never known as an English writer. An analysis of Virgil, which I jumped on at once. He said, what Virgil does, as the very phone is that he inverses the relative things which you expect to be related to one another. For instance, you will describe an army leaving, soldiers leaving a city, not being important as important as the trees and things within the city. Now this to me was an extremely interesting process, but we now inverse the values which are accepted. The values normally accepted is the city would come first, then comes the suburbs, and then comes the wild country. Now what runs down here is simple, and pushed by this common line, that's the other goal, as far as we have that, so we're pushing that whole line, which I enjoy very much. And this is what you see there is a botanical garden on top of what would be the city. And underneath this, and you can see some sections, so I'll go through it, just to show you in a short slide like this. But underneath all that is the exhibition rooms, music rooms, galleries, and so forth, all subsidiary to the concept of landscape. And then in front, to pull the whole thing together here, is a great glass arcade of about a foot of an hour long, a great noble proportion, which is pure architecture, which has to be fitted inside with immense interest and fizzle and so forth and so on. I'm crazy about it, studied for the Scotland Garden, but it got the fullest categories of music and so forth. Now, how is this? The lens of life. I'm acting, so it's a sort of sitting on the cloud, I have marvelous fun. I'm passing the bodies on the cloud, it's really nice. How does Harriet Phillips come in? Well, she is an eye drawing, and it's developed on her sketches, which I think this is pure Harriet Phillips. Now, she organizes the difficulty of the turn between left hand and this tent, the big tent here. And that's where I think that this is about as far as a landscape architect can go. And I think that an architect could probably have done that junction just as well. This is where the two worlds meet. Now, what you mustn't do at all, which you don't do at all, is anything of these. The whole of this design of Colony and underneath, but she is doing the botanical gardens here. And of course, all the surrounding stuff by her. And I think this is extremely interesting. Knowing that you have a vision of where and how the most comprehensive of the art running you see is obviously going to be the architecture. One of the contributions that I made was the creation of a great hill, which would show off the saw on that, which was on the original design. And that hill is made of a double tower, glass tower on top of it. The hill is already made, or rather, three-quarters made, and they're designing the style of the tower at the moment. Now, interestingly, if you can throw your mind back to that original sketch, it is this tower on fire, or stairways to heaven. The next slide, please. And then we come on to a silly setup. And then they say to me, you're not designing it, you're not doing it, but you've got to know that you are satisfied with the sense of landscape which we started in the third part to maintain in the second part. And so that slowly is emerging a total concept of landscape within the urban area model. Government buys urban landscape architecture. It goes beyond time planning as such, it's looking as a field as well. Now, what is interesting, what I'm very happy next week to discuss is how far the architects, can agree. This is a case where the landscape of the field, the ethos of the landscape of the field, is over a whole big area. And this is what the city wants. Obviously, if it was successful, if it was a down pressure, then probably at the same time planner. And this is something totally different. Now, this is a planner pressure, and the site itself, for about 20,000 people, is somewhere in this region here. Just that. So it's on the very edge of the Russia. The Russia itself leans up against the Alps. The Alps come down very close. Now, this is a water in this picture, but all these water areas are ex-forests. And the many fascinating things in the area, which is the area of the park, or the proposed park. These areas here are the old farms, which date back probably to the time of Virgil and even earlier. But the one farm there, which is a live farm, it's economic, it's being run by the same family when we were done. And we went on to a cup of coffee with them, and they were terrified by this, and they were getting totally submerged by the scheme. Could we get? And now we come to something, I think, of immense importance, of interest, which I was the first time I ever struck it. And this could contain the live part here, provided that you can get a natural fruit and dark fruit and all that. Live farmers, and then this is their proposal, the cemetery. Now, these two things, the cemetery and the live farm side by side, are fairly luminous, but can you get hold of an idea which can unite the two? Now, oh my god, this will be another point of fishes. And then, having felt that concept, all the fish, the moon, which moves, for the world, poor life, the boundary, cataract. The same mechanical world. In fact, these are, as you can see, the five fishes spring out of each other. And that's a good world of this world. And all for some reason, you and I like to tell it certain something that has to mention. And so what comes down, I'm a little bit bothered about why he's doing this. Thank you very much.